folks. This is Pastor Bailey, and I want to thank you for tuning in and for being a part. It's such a privilege for me to have this opportunity to come to you, to bring you the Word of the Lord, and it's such a thrill that you're on and that you're a part. And so again, thank you for tuning in, and thank you for your faithfulness in joining us for all of our services throughout the week. They make a difference for me, and I trust that they make a difference for you. I hope that you'll grab your Bibles and join me. We're going to be going to the book of Numbers today, Numbers chapter 13. And we're going to begin reading with verse 25 throughout the end of the chapter. And again, I hope that you'll get your Bible and follow along with me. And let's hear the word of the Lord to us today. The Bible says, "And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel and to the wilderness of Paran, to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told him and said, We came unto the land whither thou sent us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. And the Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of the Jordan. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. But the men that went up with him said, We be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And they brought up an evil report of the land, which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, The land which we have gone through to search, it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight." I want you to notice verse 30 again. I want to emphasize that particular statement that Caleb made. You'll notice he stilled the people, and he said, "Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it." Now, when we look at this passage of Scripture, we see in verses 1 and 2 that the Lord has instructed Moses to send out 12 spies to search the land that he had given them as a promised possession. He was ready for them to claim it, to conquer it, and to have dominion over it. And so those 12 spies, they went out, they searched, but 10 of them came back and brought up an evil report. In other words, they brought up a negative report. And these doubtful 10 affected just about everybody else. Because when you continue reading on into chapter 14, you'll notice that the Israelites continually murmured and complained against God. You know what happened? They became a whole bunch of nattering nabobs of negativity. And I want to encourage you to not be like them. In fact, that's my challenge to you tonight. Don't you be a nattering nabob of negativity. Now, that phrase first came to thought when Vice President Agnew said, in the United States today, we have more than our share of the nattering nabobs of negativism. Now, he made that statement in 1969, and sadly, over 50 years later, in 2020, that statement is very true. There are plenty of negative people in our world today, but that doesn't mean you've got to be one of them. Jesus said in John chapter 15, you are not of this world. And that's why when you read Paul in Romans chapter 12, he says, be not conformed to this world. In Ephesians chapter 2, he said, in the past, you used to walk according to the course of this world, but things are different in the present because now as a child of God, you have become a partaker of the divine nature and God has sent forth His Spirit into your hearts. And Paul says there is only righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. So as a Christian, there shouldn't be a negative bone in your body. Christians are called and created to be positive people. So I'm challenging you. In fact, I'm imploring you. Don't you be a nattering nabob of negativity. You be positive every day and in every way and with everyone that you're with. You say, well, how do I do that? How do I live my life in a perpetual state of positivity? Four things that you need to do. And I hope that you will take them to heart, write them down, and apply them to your everyday living. If you're going to be a positive person, first of all, you've got to think positive thoughts. You'll notice in verse 28, they said, nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. You see, they had already fought the battle in their mind, and the enemy had won. They were just going to settle for defeat. They chose to dwell on the obstacles instead on the opportunity. Sure, there were plenty of inhabitants in that land, men and armies that were strong and mighty. But Israel chose to settle for failure when they could possibly have had their greatest victory. They chose to think negative thoughts. And I want to encourage you, first of all, to think positive thoughts. Because one of the enemy's primary targets is your mind. He knows that if he can get through to your mind, then he can get through to your heart. Now think about that. If the enemy can get through to your mind, he can get through to your heart. That's why the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 4, and verse 23, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Another translation of that says, carefully guard your thoughts because they are the true source of life. And so I want to encourage you, stop letting negative thinking control your mindset. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 that we are to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And so don't you allow the enemy to win the battle of your mind. Instead of dwelling on the obstacles, you dwell on the opportunity that's before you. Because your greatest battle can become your greatest breakthrough. It can become your greatest victory. You need to think like that. Norman Vincent Peale wrote a powerful book entitled The Power of Positive Thinking. And in this, he makes this wonderful statement, and I quote, a positive thinker does not refuse to recognize the negative. He refuses to dwell on it. Positive thinking is a form of thought which habitually looks for the best results from the worst conditions. That's why in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8, Paul writes and he says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report." He's talking about the positive there. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Dwell on them. Let it become your mindset continually. And so if you're going to be a positive person, you have got to think positive thoughts. And then secondly, you've got to see positive sights. You'll notice in our text, those 10 spies that brought up the evil report, they said, "The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature." Notice, "And there we saw the giants of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight." They were looking through the eyes of fear instead of looking through the eyes of faith. I'll remind you, the Bible says that without faith, it is impossible to please God. And so instead of looking through the eyes of fear every day, no matter what you see, no matter what you confront, you need to be looking through the eyes of faith. You say, "Well, how do I do that?" He gives us the answer in the very next chapter in Hebrews chapter 12. He says, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. He conquered death, hell, and the grave, and he makes us his children to become more than conquerors through him." And so I want to encourage you, as you look unto Jesus, see yourself strong. For the Bible says, "Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." And then in him, see yourself capable. For we can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. And then in him, see yourself victorious. For Paul says, "Thanks be unto God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." It doesn't matter how big, how great, how mighty things look on the outside, because there is somebody that is greater that is working on the inside of you. And you need to look to him. The psalmist said, "I will lift up mine eyes into the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." See him going before you. For if God be for you, who can be against you? See him standing with you. For Jesus said, "I will never leave you nor forsake you, but lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world." And then see him working through you. "For he who hath begun a good work in you," Paul says, "shall perform it, bring it to completion until the day of Jesus Christ." Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. That's how we look through the eyes of faith. And if you're going to be a positive person, I'm telling you, you've got to see positive sights. And then thirdly, you need to hear positive sounds. You go to verse 30 and you see the Bible says, "And Caleb stilled the people before Moses." Now, why did he do that? It's because Caleb knew that they had heard enough of the negative. You see, sometimes you can get so caught up in what everybody else is saying that you just need to get still. In other words, you need to get yourself together. And then once you do, you need to change what you're hearing. That may mean that you need to cut the news off of TV. It may mean that you need to turn the radio dial while you're in the car. It may mean that you need to kindly excuse yourself and talk to somebody else, because you need to be hearing positive sounds always. You say, well, how can I do that? Two ways come to mind immediately. They are the two best ways that you can hear positive sounds. The first way is by engaging in worship. The psalmist says, praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God, for it is pleasant and praise is comely. It's pleasant not only to God's ears, but it'll be pleasant to your ears. And that's why in Ephesians chapter 5, Paul says you ought to be singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. And so engaging in worship is one way to hear positive sounds, but then a second way is by embracing the Word. Now you can do that by listening to a spoken word, or you can do that by reading the written word. But you need to be embracing the Word of God. Jesus said, the words that I give you, they are spirit and they are life. And so he who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Engaging in worship and embracing the Word, whether that be a spoken word like you're listening to now or a written word, those are the two best ways to hear positive sounds. And that's the third thing you've got to do if you're going to drive out the negative and stay in a mindset of perpetual positivity. But then there's a fourth thing, and this might be the most important of them all. You need to speak positive words. You need to speak positive words. When we look in verses 30 and 31, we see that Caleb stilled the people before Moses, and he said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. And then somebody else had to chime in, and they said, but the men that went up with him, they said, we be not able to go up against this people, for they are stronger than we are. That was negative talk. Caleb was giving positive talk. When everybody else said, we can't, Caleb said, we can. You see, the other 10, they got so caught up in thinking negative thoughts and seeing negative sights and hearing negative sounds that they ended up speaking negative words. For the Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. They were continually dwelling on, meditating on what could go wrong, what could happen. They were focusing on the negative. That's what was filling their heart. And so out of the abundance of their heart, their mouths were speaking. And that's the same for us. And you need to understand your words have consequences. The Bible says that life and power, life and death are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Jesus said, for by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Your words have consequences. If you don't believe it, you just need to continue reading Numbers 13 and 14, and you will discover that this generation of Israelites who wanted to think, hear, see, and speak the negative, they failed to possess what God had ordained for them. Oh, yes, they had the promise, but they chose to dwell on and confess the problem that was before them. And so they missed out. But Joshua and Caleb, they were the other two spies. They didn't miss out. You say, why? It's because they were faithful and they were positive to the end. And so let me challenge you. Let me encourage you. Let your words become positive. Let your speech be full of faith. Let it be uplifting. You talk faith. You confess the promises of God, for your words do indeed have consequences. And so I hope that you'll decide this day and in this moment to never be a nattering nabob of negativity. Because if you are, you might just miss out on what God has ordained for you. Oh yes, you've got a promise and He's got a plan, but it's up to you how you're going to respond to it. Understand, God has promised to work all things together for your good. When something or someone wants to stand in the way, He'll take care of it, because that's what He does and that's what He's promised you. The song says, though giants may be there our way to hinder, our God has given us the victory. He's promised it to us. He's given it to us through His Son, Jesus Christ. And so you need to hold to this promise that no matter what kind of giant, what kind of obstacle I go up against, I am well able to overcome it. For God will work all things together for my good. That's His promise to you. And then He's got a plan. And His plan is for you to reign in life. He wants you to walk in kingdom authority and to live in kingdom dominion. And so don't you be a nattering nabob of negativity. I'm telling you, there are plenty of negative people in this world, but that doesn't mean you've got to become one of them. For Jesus says, you are not of this world. You've become a part of the divine nature. And God has sent forth His Spirit into your hearts. And this Spirit, His Holy Spirit that He has given us, He produces righteousness and joy and peace continually. You're a partaker of the divine nature. The Holy Spirit lives with you. He abides with you always. And so there shouldn't be a negative bone in your body. Christians are called and created to be positive people. And so, why don't you wake up every day and declare, this is the day that the Lord has made, and I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. The Bible says that a glad heart has a continual feast, regardless of the circumstances. And so you be positive every day and in every way and with everyone that you're with. And in doing so, enjoy the feast, because God will put out a spread full of His blessings and full of His favor in your life. Sweet victory and glorious triumph will be yours. And so I'm challenging you. In fact, I'm imploring you. Don't you be a nattering nabob of negativity. Whatever God has ordained, whatever God has promised you, whatever He set out for you to conquer, know that you are well able to go up and possess it, because Jesus is on your side and the anointing of the Holy Spirit is working in you. Now we're going to pray in just a moment, and I want you to join me as we do. Before we pray, let me just express how much we love all of you. We miss you so very much. You hold a special place in our hearts, and we're looking forward to being able to see you soon and for us to be able to come back and worship together. But until that time comes, we want to encourage you to be in a continual state of prayer. Paul says that we are to pray without ceasing. And we have some needs within our church family that we want you to bring before the Lord now as we pray and all throughout the rest of this week. So let me just share with you some names. Ronnie Strickland, he is doing well and continuing to progress and recover. We want to pray that the Lord will give him strength in his body every day. Want you to lift up Anthony Wiggins, who is in need of a special miracle from the Lord, but we know that God is able to do just that in his life, so lift him up. Continue to pray for Michael and Sherlyn Whitaker, Pastor Donna Hendricks, who is doing so well, and we thank the Lord for that. Continue to pray for Izzy Pittman and Janice Branch, and then we want you to lift up Jimmy Lynn Stone. That is Pee Wee and Rose Stone's daughter. She was in a car accident last night and is in need of a miracle and a special touch from the Lord. And so lift her up, lift all of these up. This is our church prayer slide, and we're a family together. And James says that we're to pray for one another, build each other up through our prayers for the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man or a righteous woman. It accomplishes much. And so right where you are, as we bring this connection service to a close, I want you to join me for prayer. Father, we just thank you for your goodness, for your grace. We thank you for your blessings upon us. We thank you, Father, for this opportunity that you give us every week to come together, to connect with each other, and to connect with you through your word. We take what you have given us, and we pray, Father, that you would give us your strength for this moment and for this season of our lives. We make a decision this day to move forward in faith. We're not going to move forward with fear. We're going to move forward with faith. We're going to drive out the negative, and we're determined to be positive and possess that which you have promised to us. And so, Father, for my friend, for my brother, my sister who's watching this, let that perpetual state of positivity go with them and be how they think and how they walk and how they talk and live every day of their lives. And then, Father, together we lift up these names that I have called out. All of these, Lord, are in need of a physical touch in their bodies. And we thank you, Lord, that you are the great physician, that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And just like you did then, you're still going about doing good and healing all that are oppressed. And so, Father, we bring up these men and women before you. We rebuke every sickness and disease that has come against their body, and we speak healing and health and wholeness to them right now in the name of your Son, Jesus. Father, begin to ease the pain and the discomfort that they're feeling, and let a gift of divine healing be their portion this very day. We agree for this. We cling to it in Jesus' name. And Father, we give you all of the praise and all of the glory. For Lord, you are truly worthy and deserving of it. We thank you that you are with us, that you're abiding in us, working in us. And we thank you that we can do all things through you, for you are indeed our source of strength. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior. Amen.